What is the purpose of your visit to Israel? This is the question that is asked by Israeli border security to anyone that travels to the Palestinian territories. Of course, this question is accompanied by a list of other indispensable questions, such as, are you carrying any weapons? You are going to Ramallah? And of course, what is the name of your father? And your grandfather. And your great-grandfather's mother's father. All these questions, except for the last one maybe, usually have very simple answers. That is, of course, unless you're me. Oh, don't get me wrong, I've never carried any weapons, and my father and my grandfather have your standard scary Arabic names. Unfortunately for me, the answer to the first question, what is the purpose of your visit to Israel, is one word. Geothermal. Such an answer always precipitates the immediate follow-up question of, what? After which I repeat, geothermal. And after a few enlightening repetitions, finally comes, what is geothermal? At which point I pause, take a deep breath, and say, well, the Earth absorbs 50% of the sun's energy as clean, renewable energy, and as a result, the temperature in the Earth remains relatively constant throughout the entire year. After my brief explanation, the confused Israeli official then asks, really? You will do this in Israel? My response, sure, if you let me in. This, of course, happens every single time I try to enter the Palestinian territories. The first time I experienced the pleasure of an Israeli interrogation was in 2007, when I arrived on my simple quest to bring green energy to Palestine. I am the son of Palestinian refugees who were fortunate enough to immigrate to Canada. And I was raised on the imperative that if we Palestinians, who were lucky enough to grow up in one of the world's most progressive societies and receive education in amongst the best institutions in the world, if we don't come back to Palestine to help out, who will? Thus, upon graduating from university, I traveled to the Palestinian territories, and I immediately recognized a reality that was very concerning. Currently, Palestine has one of the world's highest population densities, higher than any country of similar geographic size and significantly higher than most countries around the world. In 2020, Palestine's population density will increase dramatically due to Palestine's very high population growth rate. In 2050, it is expected to surpass Bangladesh. To make matters worse, the Palestinian people pay amongst the highest energy prices in the entire Middle East and North Africa. Energy in Palestine has become unaffordable for Palestinians. This is a situation that is not sustainable. The high population growth rate in Palestine will require hundreds of thousands of new homes to be built. More homes, more buildings means more energy will be demanded, as buildings account for the majority of the energy that is consumed in Palestine. Buildings consume lots of energy for lighting, for appliances, but mainly for heating and for cooling. Considering that Palestine imports 97% of its energy and is highly dependent upon Israel for supply, we have no choice but to think outside of the box and look towards alternative forms of energy to meet the demands of Palestinians, while at the same time building more efficiently and sustainably. So, where shall we look? How about down? For who would have thought that simply 2 meters below our very feet, there lies a clean, renewable energy known as geothermal energy that can provide a source of heating and cooling for any type of building? Actually, someone already thought about it. A distant relative way back in the day, and his name was the caveman. And the cavewoman, of course. Living comfortably in a warm cave away from the outside freezing winters. Why is the cave warm while the outside air is very cold? Well, as most Israeli border security officials now know, because the earth absorbs 50% of the sun's energy, as clean renewable energy, the temperature is simply 2 meters and below remains constant throughout the entire year. So how do we access this energy? Very simple. The same way that energy in the form of heat moves around us and transfers around us every second. Humans generate heat energy. Men, of course, have to generate more energy than women to do the same amount of work. It's because they're complaining while they do it. A glass of water has heat energy. If we were to look at a glass of water at, say, 20 degrees Celsius, and we were to lower the temperature of the water from 20 to 15 degrees while keeping the amount of water the same, what are we removing from the water? You got it, energy. The same concept applies to a geothermal system. In Ramallah, we discovered that the ground temperature is a constant 17 degrees Celsius throughout the entire year. In the winter, the 17 degrees constant ground temperature is now warmer than the 4 degrees cold outside air. Thus, by pumping water into a system of pipe installed deep into the earth, we can absorb the heat from the warmer ground, channel it to an electrically powered heat pump, which then compresses the heat, outputs it to the building at 45 degrees Celsius to provide full heating. In the summer, the same exact system is simply reversed. The 17 degrees constant ground temperature is now cooler than the 36 degrees hot outside air. Thus, we absorb the building's heat, returning chilled water to the building, and we reject the building's heat to the cooler earth. According to the United States Environment Protection Agency, geothermal systems are, and I quote, the most energy efficient, environmentally clean, and cost-effective space conditioning systems available today. Installing a geothermal system in an average-sized home is equivalent to planting an acre of trees. It is also equivalent to removing two cars off the road in its environmental impact. Geothermal systems presented enormous potential. However, we face the daunting challenge of creating an affordable, real-life and replicable geothermal system, the first of its kind in the entire Middle East and North Africa, including Israel, while at the same time keeping in mind that no matter how attractive a green technology is, if it's not affordable, nobody will use it. Thus, we constantly worked on ways to reduce the cost of a geothermal system and make it more affordable to Palestinians. Such persistence led us to the discovery of using limestone powder, a free byproduct of the limestone cutting industry in Palestine, as a grout to fill our geothermal boreholes. This improved the efficiency and reduced the cost of our geothermal systems by 15%, a discovery that we recently patented. We have installed 3 geothermal systems in Ramallah, in a house, in an apartment, and in an office building. And each geothermal system has been functioning for 2 years successfully and has reduced the energy consumption by 70%. It has eliminated the carbon dioxide emissions that would have been produced by the standard fuel-burning heating system widely used in Palestine. Now, our job wasn't finished there. We were also required to bear the burden of educating our community, in addition to educating Israeli border security, on being energy efficient and environmentally friendly. We were literally creating a new green energy market from scratch in one of the poorest places in the region. We worked diligently to convince our public to look at the extra capital required to install a geothermal system as an investment rather than simply an extra cost. In the United States and Canada, it usually takes between 9 to 12 years to pay back the initial investment in a geothermal system. Because we lowered costs dramatically, and because of the high energy prices in Palestine, our payback periods are between 4 to 6 years. It was a significant challenge to do this in Palestine, and lowering costs was paramount, because if energy or if any new technology is not affordable, nobody will even think about using it. We were driven by a belief that developing countries are in fact in a unique position to incorporate renewable energy in their new constructions and actually build right. And our vision for building right was finally realized on a massive scale when we were awarded the contract to install a 1.6 megawatt geothermal system at the University of Medeba in Jordan, the largest geothermal system in the region. Once the Medeba system is complete, our geothermal systems will save a combined 300,000 kilowatt hours of electricity, 140,000 liters of diesel fuel, and 310 kilograms of carbon dioxide emissions every single year. this is the impact of a small Palestinian green energy business. We're trying to keep Palestine cool from the ground up. I guess it must have worked since a representative from the Israeli Ministry of National Infrastructure sent us an email saying, quote, "I'm impressed. Looks like we have a lot to learn from you." Actually, Palestinian TV was also very excited as they referred to me as, quote, "the inventor of geothermal," which is not true, of course, but I appreciate the thought. Although, in the end, our hard work did pay off, we faced many challenging obstacles along the way, starting with, of course, the Israeli occupation. In 2009, I became a victim of Israel's campaign of entry denials and visa restrictions directed towards foreign nationals working in Palestine. For one straight year, I became the target of a systematic, deliberate, and discriminatory effort designed to prevent me from entering or working in the Palestinian territories. I was denied entry by Israel 3 times in the span of 7 months. Was the Palestinian green energy business a threat to Israeli security? Well, I am originally from Gaza, and we were drilling holes. I guess you can count them as tunnels. Maybe Israeli border security was just fed up with my geothermal speech. Or maybe, just maybe, it's simply Israel's military occupation, now entering its 44th year, as it was the Israeli occupation army that randomly detained one of my young, hardworking engineers. We had just finished training him as a certified geothermal designer by bringing an expert to train him from Canada. What was his reward? He was detained, thrown in solitary confinement in a holding cell the size of a box for 2 months under no charges. There were also the challenges of operating a business in the developing world. I had, and I still have to this very day, an extremely difficult time hiring educated professionals in Palestine. Oh, don't get me wrong, it's not because there aren't any. On the contrary, Palestinians are amongst the most educated people in the Middle East. It's a result of the massive amounts of foreign aid that is injected into the Palestinian economy, now totaling 30% of Palestinian GDP. International aid allows non-governmental organizations, NGOs, the ability to offer inflated salaries, far detached from the local economy, to lure educated Palestinians. Salaries 3 to 4 times higher than what the local private sector can afford. This causes labor costs to increase while decreasing labor supply and undermining the private sector's ability to recruit educated Palestinians, and thus our capacity to build an independent Palestinian economy. Now, and the obstacles didn't stop there. There was now the neighboring government of Jordan with their wonderful technicolor web of bureaucracy. Before we could start working on the University of Medeba geothermal system, the Jordanian government forced us to receive approvals from the Ministry of Public Works and the Ministry of Industry and Trade and the Ministry of Interior and the Jordanian Intelligence Agency, and the Prime Minister's Office, and the Ministry of Water, the Ministry of Energy, and the Ministry of Environment. And the Jordanian Contractors Union, and the Jordanian Engineering Association. I was actually thankful that they didn't force us to get approval from the Jordanian Manly Mustache Association. Our small green energy business was forced to pay salaries and overheads and keep its employees and equipment on standby for 5 months while awaiting approvals. Although we as a people face many challenging obstacles living under occupation, building sustainably is not one of them. In spite of the obstacles we faced as a business, we continue to install geothermal systems, and we continue to work towards creating a more sustainable economy for Palestine. We're working towards our own solution for Palestine. Not the two-state solution, nor the one-state solution, but the green state solution. Save Palestine, please. So, what is the purpose of my visit to Israel? First of all, it's to Palestine. And second of all, it's to prove that the power of an idea combined with creative entrepreneurship and a huge amount of Palestinian stubbornness is far greater than any obstacle that lies in its way. It's also to prove that if we can build sustainably here in Palestine in the face of extraordinary obstacles, then every country in the world, including the underprivileged, can build sustainably and build their communities right. Although we may have known that the power to build our communities right lies in our own hands, I hope we now know that the energy to do so lies below our feet. Welcome to a different kind of underground movement, the movement to create an independent geothermal Palestine. Thank you very much.
Khaled is an amazing person, and I really want to just point something out. He worked very hard on his talk, very hard on his speech, and I think the results speak for themselves with what you've seen. And also a question, how did you choose engineering?
it's actually a funny question. I actually wanted to study political science, believe it or not. And my father took a hard look at me and said, "Son, you're Palestinian. Your life is going to be politics. Study something else."
Personally, I hope that you get to tell more stories. Is this the only kind of story you have to tell?
No, inshallah we'll have plenty more stories to tell and plenty more projects to show that are successful and plenty more messages to send around the world, and this is why TEDx is a great organization. It's to allow us to tell the world that we do have inspirational stories, and it isn't all negative attention about Palestine. We have so many positive stories and so many examples to set to everybody around the world.
This is the last one. TEDx is about spreading ideas. It's not really about doing business, but really I think the idea, this is an important one in terms of protecting the environment and actually doing something positive from here. What would you ask the audience if you could have them do something that would help this happen more? Would you say, I'll even say on a business scale, can people do this in their houses?
Absolutely, absolutely. Look, we have to change the way we look at how we build today. It's paramount to the success of the building of our country and our future and how what we transfer to our future generations. We literally have no choice but to focus on sustainable urban development. And you have to look at this as an investment in our future. Yes, renewable energy technology does cost more than conventional technologies that are available today, but it's an investment. It's an investment that pays itself off, actually, better than most investments that are available. It has an excellent return on its investment, and it's sustainable. And it's paramount that we sort of think outside the box and, like I said, look down and look towards other technologies that are available.
So you're saying Palestinians can save money? That's brilliant. Thank you very much, Khaled Sabaoui.
Thank you very much.
Good luck.